Okay, good morning to everyone. Welcome back. Since yesterday, I think we're ready to start the morning sessions. You will see that on every chair there is a bag that is it's meant to be for you, courtesy of the organizers. Okay, so let's get started straight away. So the first speaker today is Sanjay Rangungam from Greenberry.
Participated in several of these workshops over the years. So I'm going to be talking about the official title is Transportation. Some algebra is related to permutations. I hope to get there. But basically, let's start with, we're going to be talking about permutations. And we're going to be talking about the relation between permutations and a class of problems which a priori don't look like they obviously have anything to do with permutations. So on the one hand, we have the world of discrete things, permutations, which are very well-defined, beautiful mathematical things. And there are other beautiful mathematical things which look a bit more complicated, where you have a group, a continuous group. In all the examples I will be thinking about, they are, for example, UN, or they could be UN1 times UN2, products of unitary groups. And you have a group which acts on a space. So, a space. A group that acts on a space.
Is the space a vector space or more general?
So I will, be a bit more specific. So, concretely, the spaces that I will be looking at, in example one, you have a space of n by n. So in the example one, G is UN. The space is a space of n by n matrices. Let's call it, let's think about a set of matrix variables. So this is Z11, Z12, Z1n. It's a set of matrix variables, Zij's. So it's a matrix of size n. And there is a group action. So by that, I mean, you give me a group element, and you give me a matrix. I give you, it's a map from the space G cross S to G, to S. Uz, and I consider Uz U dagger. And what we're interested in is, we have complex matrices, and there's a group action, Z goes to Uz U dagger, and we are interested in functions of the Z, which are invariant under the group action. So, just so it doesn't sound very mysterious, for example, if you have trace Z, if I take Z goes to UZ dagger, U is a unitary matrix, simplicity. So this is a function of the matrix entries. It's just the sum of the diagonals. So it's a function of the matrix entries, which is invariant under the group action. In fact, this is a polynomial invariant function, just a linear function of some of these things. more generally, you could have things like trace of any power. You can have products of traces. All these are functions of my complex matrix. These are all functions that are holomorphic, and they are invariant under this group action. In fact, one might be interested in taking, so this would be related to taking the space and forming a quotient by this group action. And you know, you try to understand that space, but actually a lot of the time when a space is complicated, it's better to understand the space of functions on it. So when you have a quotient, space of functions on that quotient are the functions which are invariant. Okay. So I have a space of functions of matrix Z, and all these functions are polynomial invariant functions. There's a whole area of mathematics called polynomial, where you study polynomial invariants of matrices. So in this case, it's a well-studied problem in the one matrix case, which solution has been known for a long time. The next example I will talk about is where you have UN, and then you are acting on a space of functions of two matrices, Z. We're interested in functions of Z and Y. And the group action is that you give me a U, you give me a ZY. ZY goes to U, Z, U dagger. And Y goes to U, Y, U dagger. So this is the kind of thing in physics you would encounter if you have a field theory or quantum mechanics or anything, where these are your fields and these are in the adjoint of your group, UN, and you are interested in functions of your elementary fields which are invariant under the gauge symmetry. So this will be a problem of looking at the gauge invariant functions of two adjoint matrix variables. So this will come up, for example, if you are looking at N equals 4 super Young Mills, where you have six Hermitian matrix fields, and let's say in some sector one is interested in two complex combinations, Z and Y, and we're looking at all the gauge invariants. So this is a problem of polynomial invariants. You could fix the degree M, how many Z's you have, you fix the degree N, how many Y's you have, and you have a parameter capital N, which tells you the size of the matrices and the size of the gauge. So that's the second problem. And there is a third problem where, again, the structure of permutations and so on will also be useful. You could have, for example, rather than matrices, you could have a tensor of higher rank. Let's say you have one tensor which transforms in the fundamental V, tensor V, tensor V of UN times UN times UN. In other words, you have these three indices which transform, so you have one U1 inside this product group which transforms this index, another U2 which transforms that index, and a U3 which transforms that index. And you have a phi bar, a complex conjugate, where this transforms into the conjugate, where you have fundamental, anti-fundamental. These are anti-fundamental indices, and you're interested in constructing, let's say, invariants of some degree. And that means you want invariants that will have n phi's. And it turns out, in order to have an invariant function, if you have n phi's, you will need n phi bars. Just the fact that basically, I will get to this more, when you have invariants of UN and you have a bunch of fundamental indices and a bunch of anti-fundamental indices, the only way to build an invariant is to contract the indices. Okay, so the number of indices, each one of these indices has to be one of those, and so on. But there are different orderings in which you can do that. So in all these problems, these two problems arise in N equals 4 super Young Mills, which is motivated by studying ABS CFG. And this is another problem which arises in tensor models, for example. And so I want to show you how in all these different problems, there's a kind of unifying structure of permutations which helps you solve these problems. So let's start with the first example. So the problem on this side is to kind of enumerate, count all the invariants, invariant functions, invariant polynomial functions. If you've worked on, a lot of you will have worked on ABS CFG, you know, things like trace set to the end. These are things that you could insert at some space-time point. They are local, they correspond to local operators in your theory, and you can calculate correlation functions, trace that to the end, trace that dagger to the end, and you want to know what is that function. So, for the conformal field theory, as in the main application here, the ABS-CFT, the space-time dependence is very simple. And you have some function that depends on what you insert here. And if you have some products of traces, which we will have in general, then there's some function of what trace you put in. So the problem is to understand what these functions are and to use permutations to calculate these functions. And I will be able to say in a bit of detail how this works for the one matrix case, a little bit of detail for the two matrix case, but some of the work I'm reporting is based on work which also includes, you know, this tensor model stuff. So, but hopefully you'll get a flavor of how this whole application of permutations works. Okay, great. So we have the functions of polynomial functions of one matrix. So, as we said, if I fix the number of z's, I can have trace z to the end. Let's say n equals 3. Looking at eigenvariant functions of z, where I have 3 z's, so I can have things like trace z cubed, trace z squared, times trace z, or I can have trace z. Right, so this, in other words, if you look at what's going on here, the three z's could be put in one trace, 3 equals 3, all in one trace, or they could be 2 plus 1, z squared z, or 1 plus 1 plus 1. So the number of gauge invariants as a function, number of gauge invariants for degree n is p of n. So this number, the number of ways of splitting n into positive integers, that's called the number of partitions of n. So here what I've shown you, that p of 3 is 3. This number, if you wanted to know, well, what is p of 100 or 10,000 or whatever, what can you, there's a nice way to describe these numbers in the following form.
Is this truly regardless of what is the size of matrix, right?
This is true when n is less than capital N, and I will be saying that I can say, you know, what happens for capital n bigger than n, but let's restrict to this little n being less than capital N. So take this P of n x to the n, sum over n equals 0 infinity. So you have a set of numbers, and very often it's useful to define a generating function. So rather than thinking about all these numbers, let me just think of one function whose expansion produces all these numbers. And what is known is that this function is a nice infinite product, 1 to infinity, 1 over 1 minus x to the minus. Classic result in mathematics, partitions, counting partitions. Good. So we have a numerator.
Okay, this is independent of capital N.
So there is a number which is valid for all little n and big n. And that number is a fixed function whenever n is less than capital N. And I'm just talking at the moment about that function.
But you summed over infinity, right?
Sure. So this number, a billion, will be relevant for any capital N bigger than a billion. So just look at this equation. So this, for all N less than capital N, so N is a variable, it's not a fixed thing. So I have this P of N, and I want to know what that P of N is. That tells you what it is. Just to tell you what happens with capital N, if I'm working at a fixed capital N, I will be interested in, the answer will be that you count the partitions of little n such that no part is bigger than capital N. That is the capital.
In terms of eigenvalues of Z, you can write down some wild invariant polynomials of that order, whichever you are interested in, right?
Yes.
Whatever is the number of Pn.
P of n is just, what I've defined here. Is this definition clear? I give you a number, think about how many ways you can write that number as a sum of positive integers. That is P of n. For any fixed finite n, that won't tell you everything you want to know, but it'll tell you the answer to this counting problem whenever the degree of the invariant is less than capital N. We can say more about the most general thing, but I won't say it now. So this P of n, there are some nice relations between P of n and the symmetric group Sn. So the symmetric group Sn is the group of all permutations and factorial permutations of n objects. So if you take 1, 2, 3, there are different ways of rearranging it. You can take the permutation 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 2, 1, 2. So there are six permutations for S3. And two of them are cyclic permutations. This one says that the permutation is a rearrangement. So this one says 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 1. And this one says 1 goes to 3, 3 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1. This is called the cycle notation for permutations. And there are two permutations of the cyclic form. There are three permutations of this other cyclic form, 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 2, and 2, 3. And there's a third permutation, the last permutation, which is, this is 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 3. So you see, there are six permutations.
The last one is 3 to 1.
The last one?
The, yeah,
1, 2, 1, 3. 1, 3, 2, 2, 3, 1. So by this cycle, this cycle notation, so 1, 2, 3, is being, it goes to 1, goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, 3 goes to 3. And then, so from the cycles, you can read off the rearrangement. Okay? So, of the six permutations, there are two which have cycle structure. Let's call it 3, because 3 within a cycle. And 3 which are 2 plus 1, and 1 which is 1 plus 1 plus 1. Now you start seeing an analogy with the trace structures. We had trace Z cubed, and then we had trace Z squared, trace Z, and then you have trace Z the whole cube. So the counting of trace structures is the same as the counting of cycles of permutations. And this is a very general thing for the following reason. When you are trying to build a gauge invariant function of Z I1, so when you write out the trace Z cube, for example, something like Zij, Jk, Zki, index notation, you have a bunch of indices above and a bunch of indices below, and you see that the indices below are the same set of indices as above, but some rearrangement. So the neat way to describe it is you call this one I1 up to IN, and the indices below are going to be I sigma of 1 up to I sigma of n. Let's call that the function O sigma of Z. So for every permutation, I have a gauge invariant operator. So this formula is good to look at, because another way to write it is you write it as Z I1 J1 up to Z I n J n, and then you have delta J1 up to delta J n I sigma of 1 I sigma of n. These indices I just call them J's, and then these are the J's. So if I sum over J's, this is the same as that. This is a good way to think about things, because what that says is that you can introduce a gadget, which I didn't really, you can introduce a vector space. You know, matrices are linear operators, right? So when I'm looking at this Zij, I have a really linear operator acting on a vector space. That's how we get matrices on linear. A set of numbers that describe linear operators given a choice of bases. So Z EI is Z IJ EJ, sum over J. Now, it is useful in order to understand that formula better and its properties to think about the vector space V tensor little n, where little n is the number of z's I'm interested in, and V is a, what is the dimension of V? For the students, a little quiz here, wake you up. What is the dimension of V in terms of data I've already described?
Rings on the line.
Yes, students here. Z is a matrix. What was the size of the matrix Z? Capital N. That's right, thank you. So, therefore, Z is a linear operator acting on a vector space of dimension N. That means I goes from 1 to capital N. So a good way to think about that formula is to take this fundamental representation of UN, take the n-fold tensor product, and this gadget here I1, J1, and so on, is actually what is that? It's kind of Z tensor N. These are the matrix elements of Z tensor N acting on this vector space, I1 tensor IN. And then I'm taking the matrix element. That's what that is. Now, what is that thing? It's just a combination of deltas. That combination of Kronecker deltas is also a matrix element, not of this guy, of something else. It's a matrix element of a linear operator. Here's a linear operator acting on I1 tensor. What it is you take these n factors, whatever vector you see, first, second, or third, you reshuffle them by this permutation, this rearrangement. So this goes to e to the I sigma of 1, e to the I sigma of 1. If I want to calculate the matrix element of that linear operator, I overlap it with the two more vectors. And that's that delta, J1 I sigma 1 up to JN I sigma 1. So when you see that delta, that's the matrix element of a linear operator corresponding to a permutation acting on tensor space. So then there's a neat way to write this. What this is trace of Z tensor N composed with sigma and the whole thing acting in the N-fold tensor product, right? So the sigma will act and will give you these guys, the Z will give you these guys, and then the lower and upper indices are contracted. That's why it's a trace. I just erased along with, well, these two formulas I just erased, they show you one important general property of this parameterization, O sigma of Z, which was Z I1 I sigma 1 I n I sigma n, which was also I wrote it some other ways. So using that formula, you can see the following. O gamma sigma gamma inverse Z is the same as O sigma of Z. And this comes about because basically I1 J1 up to Z, INJN. Let's look at this, I1, J1, to INJN. It's the same if I put Z, I, gamma of 1, J, gamma of 1, up to Z, I, gamma of N, J, gamma of N. Why is that?
Gamma is
any permutation. Basically, it's saying that rather than having Z, I1, J1 here, you know, I could have I3, J3 here, but these are bosons, so I'm allowed to do that. So, as it, so this is, we said, this is the matrix elements of Z, tensor N, acting on tensor space. What is this? Think about it a little bit. It's the matrix element of Z, tensor N, gamma conjugated, gamma inverse Z, tensor N, gamma. You use, here's an exercise for the students. I told you what are the matrix elements of gamma. You act on the EIs, overlap with the EJs. Do that, apply that, and what you will get, convince yourself that what you're getting is exactly that, which from the bosonic property of Z is equal to that. that's the exercise. So this O sigma of Z is trace B tensor N, Z tensor N sigma. What we have shown is that this Z tensor N is the same as gamma Z tensor N, gamma inverse. And these are all linear operators acting in tensor space. And this is a trace, so there's cyclicity. So this is trace B N tensor N, Z tensor N, gamma inverse sigma gamma. So this proves for you that this O sigma of Z doesn't change if I take the sigma and I conjugate it by any gamma in Sn. So what that says is that it turns out the implications of this are rather deep. It implies that basically I can just study permutations, but subject to the equivalences. If I just study permutations and I treat permutations which are related to each other by conjugation as belonging to the same equivalence class, and I study intrinsically in the world of permutations, what are the properties of these equivalence classes? I will know everything I need to know about the one matrix problem, including finite, and I'll get to that later. So this equation is very important. As an illustration of the fact that this is not just a complicated way of writing obvious things, let me tell you one application.
The general complex matrix is not Hermitian.
At the moment, these are all general complex matrices. But you would also, everything I said, all I used here was a bosonic property. So this is also a good way to parameterize invariants of Hermitian matrices.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So in the ADS CFT application, one is interested in, for example, the simplest way to describe one calculation that comes up in ABS CFT is you integrate over the matrices. I won't be too precise about the measure here. And there's a Gaussian weight. And then you have some function, some multi-trace of Z, and some multi-trace of Z down. I want to know what that general correlate is, a two-point function that will come up in supernumbers. So this is a reduced model, where it's just a matrix model, but when I calculate that, I'll get a function of sigma 1 and sigma 2, which is relevant to ADS CFT, but I just want to focus on what that function is. And the function, it turns out, is very simple. It's, is sum over gamma in symmetric group Sn, delta, gamma, delta sigma 1, gamma, sigma 2, gamma inverse, sigma 2, n, size of the matrix, to the power of C. I'll explain this formula. It's in it, but this is the formula. So what's in this formula? There's a delta. So what does the delta mean? Delta so sigmas are permutations in Sn. There are n factorial of these guys. One of them is the identity, which is the trivial rearrangement. 1, 2, 3 up to n goes to 1, 2, 3 up to n. In cycle notation, it's just 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 2. Delta of sigma is a function defined on Sn which says this is equal to 1 if sigma is the identity permutation, and it's 0 if sigma is not that. This delta is also defined if you have a linear combination of, if I take a formal sum of permutations, delta, lambda, sigma, sigma, sum of the sigma, I extend it by linearity, it's been lambda of the identity. So it's the delta of the product of permutations. One of them is the first observable that I put in, the second one is the second observable I put in. This gamma is a sum that comes from the Wick contractions that arise when I take a Z and Z dagger. If I'm doing this in a free Gaussian theory, I put a bunch of Zs and a bunch of Z daggers. In any Gaussian model, I'm calculating these integrals. It's a product of two-point functions, so a product of Zs and Z daggers. But how I pair them, there's a sum of all possible pairings. That sum is here. So you take sigma 1 for the first observable, sigma 2 for the second, conjugated sum of all possible ways of conjugating. And what this delta says, multiply these two, whatever it is equal to, call it sigma 3 inverse. So this delta function constrains that this is the inverse of that. Take that product of permutations and just count how many cycles there are in there. And n to the power of the number of cycles. That's the answer. Sigma 3, this is just a slightly nicer way to write. Let me write it in a simpler way, which might make it. So I could just write this as n to the number of cycles in the permutation sigma 1, gamma, sigma 2, gamma inverse. So this one is just saying it's the number of cycles in that permutation, which is this product. Just a slightly neater way to write it, but you could write it this way as well. You sum over the Wick contractions, you multiply sigma 1 with this conjugated guy, count the number of cycles, that's the power. So if anybody's interested in the derivation, I can explain it later, or I'm sure there are many experts, you know, this is a center for this kind of calculations. So Robert and his generations of students and postdocs have done this. So anybody who doesn't know how to derive this, you can ask your elders, and or you can ask me, of course. So any question? Yes.
Essentially, you're summing over the sigma 3 here, and you're only picking out the one term which does that.
Exactly. So from here to here, that's all it is. But why is this true? It's if you look at it the right way, it's an easy calculation. So if we stare at that formula, obviously it has to have some nice properties that we, you know, even if you don't derive it, let's check that it has a right property. So this function, sigma 1, sigma 2, should be the same if I conjugate sigma 1, because the observable only depends on the conjugacy class. Or I conjugate this guy by another. So here's another exercise. You can take that formula and check that if I conjugate sigma 1 and sigma 2, I get the same answer. For example, if I sigma 1 to the right, I have a mu 1 inverse. Basically, these mu's can be absorbed in the gamma. So that's an exercise for you. Given this invariance, there's yet another nice way to write it, which is this f of sigma 1, sigma 2 is actually, you take sigma 1, let's call it sigma 1 prime. This is going to be summed over all permutations, because this function is, you know, invariant in the conjugation, I can average it. I can write this as a sum and then 1 over some factor, right? So take everything which is conjugate to sigma 1, which is everything in the same cycle structure. take sigma 1 prime, which is everything in the same cycle structure, and sigma 2 prime, everything in the same cycle structure of sigma 2, and this is delta sigma 1, sigma 2, and then sigma 3, and the C sigma 3. With a normalization factor, which we won't worry about. It's a very simple question. So now, when you write it this way, you have a couple of steps to the following mathematical thing that you would just study in group theory, in SN group theory. So take, for example, you know, we were looking at these classes, right? So these cycle structures, 1, 2, plus 1, 3, plus 2, 3. Take all the permutations with a specified 2 plus 1 cycle structure, add them. What does it mean to add group atoms? Well, in itself it doesn't mean anything, but you can define something called the group algebra, which is defined as a vector space where you're allowed to take linear combinations of group elements. So take that. All things with equal coefficient. Take some other cycle structure, 1, 2, 3, plus 1, 3, 2. Okay, so this is the, let's call it T, the sum of everything in the cycle structure 2 plus 1, times T, sum of everything in the cycle structure 3. You can do this multiplication, that and that and that and so on. You can re-expand that. So C1, 2 times, let's say, T alpha. So if you take the sum of permutations with a given cycle structure and another sum in another cycle structure, you can multiply them to get something else which involves sums in specified cycle structures with some coefficients. So this forms a nice algebra. There's an algebra of conjugacy classes. So what this is telling you is that the two-point function is given in terms of the structure constants of an algebra, which is the algebra intrinsic to symmetric groups. So this is kind of interesting because it's, so this by the way, is a nice algebra. You can convince yourself that, maybe it's a little bit of work, but it's a commutative algebra. So exercise, it's a commutative algebra. It's a commutative associative algebra. And its structure constant determine the two-point function. So what has happened here is kind of interesting. Yet another way of writing. What has happened is that we have O sigma 1 of Z, and then O some operator, and then there is, in fact, you can define a product that we call the star product, where you take this T1 times T2, the corresponding class sums, multiply them, re-expand them, and for each of them, you have a gauge invariant operator. So the space of, these are half BPS operators, so the space of half BPS operators have a commutative associative product on them, where you take something of degree n, something else of degree n, you get a third thing of degree n. The usual product of traces of polynomials adds the degrees. Here, you just take a star product coming from adding the multiplying permutations, and then you can use that star product to compute the two-point functions, for example. So there's an interesting hidden associative star product inside. So what happens with two matrices? Well, once you think about the invariants in this way, yeah.
So I just wanted to know what guarantees the associativity of that star product.
Basically, it comes from the fact that you know, this star product comes from this algebra.
Yeah, associativity.
So that algebra is associative.
Translated.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's kind of, this comes from that algebra. So associativity comes from here. The fact that it's also a commutative algebra. And where does the commutativity come from? That's because any of these T's, what are they? They are, to take some permutation, you just take all the conjugates, and then you have to divide by some symmetry factor, which is the number of permutations which leave this fixed. It's a nice thing. But if you look at something like that, if you multiply it by, let's say, alpha on the left, and then you can redefine the gamma, and then your alpha appears on the other side. So these class sums are commutative things for that reason. So it's a commutative associative algebra. In the two matrix case, which I'll talk about now, this will become a associative but non-commutative algebra. And there will be a very interesting thing that will appear there. Which, if you have a non-commutative algebra, what is the center of that algebra? And the center means the subspace which commutes with everything within that algebra. And so we'll talk about that very soon. So what happens with two matrices? You know, so I spent a bit of time on this one matrix, that partly because all these things have nice generalizations. Two matrices. O sigma of ZY. I want to look at polynomial invariant functions of a given degree m, m copies of z, n y's. You can do that by thinking about this operator. And trace the n as z. And using this formula, you can show that just to make it a bit concrete, so you have z I1 of z I m, y I m plus 1, y I m plus n, I sigma of 1 up to I sigma of n plus n. So the indices below are just some permutation of the indices above. Sigma is a permutation of m plus n objects. And there will be some redundancy as before. There'll be a redundancy having to do with reordering the z's, gamma 1 in Sn. And there'll be a gamma 1, gamma 2 in Sn. In fact, this S1, gamma 1 and gamma 2, you could write as gamma 1 circle gamma 2, which is something inside Sn cross Sn, which is a subgroup of Sm plus n. So the redundancy that you have is O sigma of Zy is O gamma gamma inverse gamma sigma gamma inverse of Z and Y, where gamma is in the subgroup. So sigma is in the bit group, and gamma is in the subgroup. So that is the redundancy that you have. So one immediate application of this equation is how many invariants are there? Count invariants. What is the number of these multi-trace operators made out of two matrices? Again, I'm looking at capital N sufficiently large. So this invariant theory problem is mapped entirely into the world of permutation groups. It's counting equivalence classes in as n plus n, where sigma is equivalent to gamma sigma gamma inverse if gamma is in the subgroup. So the way to think about this equivalence is you have a subgroup gamma acts on S n plus n. So here's a set, for the moment it suffices to think of this as a set, and you know, a set of things. This guy and this guy are in the same equivalence class if this is gamma times that times gamma inverse for some gamma in the subgroup. So using this, you can organize your whole set into orbits. Which guys belong to the same equivalence class, and partition it into orbits. And there's a nice formula from combinatorics, which is whenever you have a group, finite group, acting on a set, you have the number of orbits is 1 over the size of the group times the number of fixed points. What does that mean? So, converting this into a formula, you write this as 1 over the size of the group. Again, the students here. Sm times Sn, what's the size of the group? All permutations of m things times all permutations of n things.
N factorial.
M factorial times n factorial. And the number of fixed points, okay? So a fixed point is when you have sigma. What is a group action? Group action is gamma, sigma, gamma inverse. If it's fixed, that means this is left fixed, which means gamma, sigma, gamma inverse is 1. So this is a sum over gamma, sum over sigma. Delta, gamma, sigma, gamma inverse, sigma inverse. Okay. Now, this is, again, a delta function on the group. And these delta functions on groups have a nice.
S is the full permutation group.
Yeah. This is in the Sm plus n. This is the Sm cross Sn.
It's not cyclic group. It's permutation.
The whole permutation. The reason that's coming up is because we're looking at multi-traces. If you're focusing on a single trace, it's a cyclic. We'll look at trace and multi-traces. So once you count all multi-traces, there's a simple formula to get the single traces. Something called statistic log. But this is all multi-traces. So that's that. And I think the next step I will do with that is very also something of very general, kind of there's a nice general lesson here, which is that the other thing, so what are we using for? We're using the symmetric group, products, subgroups. The other thing that you can use with finite groups is something very nice called Fourier transformation on the finite group. Where does Fourier transformation on a group, finite group come from? It comes from representation theory. And among other things, what Fourier transformation does, you know, gives you a formula for delta function, like in U1 or on a circle. Delta of theta, you can write as an expansion. Delta of sigma has an expansion, which can be written out in terms of a sum over irreducible representations of S. So sigma, in this case sigma is in S n plus n. You sum over all irreducible representations of S n plus n, which correspond to Young diagrams of n plus n, which corresponds to partitions of n plus n. And you take dr, the dimension of that representation, times the character. So this formula is analogous to what you would see in Fourier series. Delta of theta on a circle is in. So created an analogous thing where you anything that you're doing intrinsically with permutations, you can relate it to things you do with representations. So that formula, you can also rewrite it. So the number of operators as a function of M and N, you can also write it using representations. And what the formula turns out to be is you sum over Young diagrams with M boxes, Young diagrams with N boxes, and Young diagrams with M to N boxes. What is the weight? The weight is the Littlewood-Richardson coefficient. This is a way of coupling two Young diagrams with M and N boxes to get one with M plus N boxes, but there's a multiplicity. That multiplicity is called G. Take that multiplicity and you square it. That is equal to that. When you convert permutation world into representation world. You know, you do that in this formula, and you need one more formula for the students who are going to work this out. The number of this Littlewood-Richardson coefficient can itself be written in terms of characters. So 1 over n factorial, sum over sigma 1 Sm, sigma 2 Sn, chi r 1 sigma 1, chi r 2 sigma 2, chi r 3 sigma 1 circle sigma 2. The Littlewood-Richardson coefficient can be written in terms of characters. You take characters of sigma 1 in the small group, sigma 2 in the next group, Sm and Sn, and then you compose these two to get something in the subgroup, Sm plus n. And that is equal to the Littlewood-Richardson coefficient, and that is equal to that. So this is another useful thing which I will use in the next talk. But as a way to end this first part, let me just say that using this and doing some writing out in terms of the cycle, you know, permutations, these all depend on cycle structure, so you write out in terms of cycle structures, and then you can get an A formula for these numbers, B, M, N. Okay, so this is the number of gauge invariant operators with M, Zs, and NYs. Again, to describe these numbers, you can invent a generating function. And what is that generating function? It's an infinite product so this generalizes formula we had for partitions, but now it's counting all possible multi-traces where things don't commute, and so on. And this formula can also be derived, again, from this delta function. And again, to anybody who's interested in the details,
how much time is it?
Time's
up? 5 minutes.
Oh, 5 minutes then. All right, good. So, so this notion of equivalence then is also applicable to the two matrix problem. So the summary of what we have seen so far then is that in the two matrix problem, again, we are studying equivalences where gamma is in the subgroup. And the other thing that we saw is that in order to count the gauge invariant operators, these numbers come up, the Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. And just to connect with what I said at the end of the discussion on the half BDS guys, given these equivalence classes, we have an algebra. So take any sigma 1, consider the average gamma gamma inverse, where gamma is in the subgroup now. Take any sigma in the big group, just average it by conjugating with something in the subgroup. What is the property of such a thing? It commutes with the subgroup. It is something in the group algebra of the big group as M plus N. It is a linear combination of things in the big group, but it commutes with the subgroup. And if you take two expressions like this, you can multiply them, because they all live in the big algebra. And this is an associative algebra. So this multiplication of the subspace of things which commute forms an algebra. One thing commutes, another thing commutes, the product commutes. So these, the subspace of the group algebra of S n plus n, which commutes with this, the subspace I've specified, forms an algebra. Okay, and it's associative because this mother algebra is associative. Is it commutative? If I take one of these things times something else of the same form, that other thing is some generic element in the big algebra. It doesn't have to commute with this. Only things, this by construction, commutes with everything in the subgroup. It doesn't commute with the generic thing in the algebra. So two such things, when I multiply them, have an associative but non-commutative product. So there is a non-commutative and associative product. So it's a nice algebra in that sense. And also it has a nice non-degenerate pairing. Take two of them, two elements in this algebra, you could get a number. And that pairing essentially comes from pairings in the big algebra having to do with delta sigma 1 sigma 2. So in the big algebra, there's a pairing, you multiply that, you take a delta function. Yeah. You know, in the group algebras of symmetric groups, there's a nice pairing where you multiply them and then you take the delta that we saw. It's a nice non-degenerate pairing. And this algebra itself has a nice pairing inherited from the big algebra. So nice pairing. And when you have anytime you have an algebra like this, non-commutative, associative, nice pairing, such an algebra is always isomorphic to a direct sum of matrix algebras. It's called the Wedderburn-Artin theorem. So it's a direct sum of matrix algebras. And how do I label this direct sum? Well, the hint is in this formula for the counting. So the counting for gauge invariant operators was a sum of having to do with little, I'll continue this in the next talk. There was a formula for the counting of gauge invariant operators, which is a sum over Young diagrams of the Littlewood-Richardson coefficient square. And the fact that this was a square, that's the dimension of a matrix algebra, of a matrix algebra, of dimension equal to the Littlewood-Richardson coefficient. So this algebra that I've just defined has a direct sum decomposition as matrix algebras, where the blocks, these matrices, matrix blocks, corresponds to triples of Young diagrams with non-vanishing Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. So this is very useful in order to deal with finite n constraints and so on. So I'll continue with the next.